Hello everyone, thanks to everyone for watching this video. My name is Qi Dang. I am an architect and engineer. Today's video is titled Nonlinear Procedures, and it is going to provide you the fundamentals of material strength and also the solution methods of nonlinear finite element analysis. I am going to give you an overview of what I am covering in today's video. Firstly at all, it is a bit of background to the topic, and then focus on the Newton-Raphson method and the arc length method before wrapping up with conclusions. Stress is a measure of the stress a material can withstand. Two different values are typically used to define the strength of a material, the ultimate strength and the yield strength. Let's define them by taking a look at the stress strain curve obtained from a tensile test. The ultimate tensile strength of material is defined as the maximum stress which is reached during the tensile test. Corresponding to this point on the stress strain curve, it is the maximum stress the material can withstand during a tensile test. The yield strength is defined as the stress at which a material begins to deform plastically. Stressing a material beyond its yield strength will result in permanent deformation after the load is removed. Many structures and components are designed to ensure that they only deform elastically. This makes the yield strength a commonly used criteria for defining failure in engineering design codes. It is possible for failure to occur at stress levels well below the yield strength if the applied load varies with time. For some materials, the transition from elastic to plastic deformation is not clearly defined. In these cases, the yield strength can be defined using the 0.2% offset method. This involves drawing a line with the slope equal to Young's modulus and shifting it 0.2% to the right on the stress strain curve. So far, we have only discussed strength in the tensile direction. But what about the compressive direction? Tensile tests are usually easier to carry out than compression tests, and so compression tests are not often performed for these materials. For brittle materials, like concrete, however, the material strength is much larger in compression than in tension. From the stress strain curve, we know that it is a nonlinear relationship. We have two of the most common numerical methods to express the nonlinear behavior. They are Newton-Raphson's method and the arc length method. In Newton-Raphson method, the incremental loading is expressed. The external load vector fx is gradually increased from zero in order to reach a desired value f. Assuming that f value itself remains constant during the analysis in terms of its direction and only its magnitude is changing, we can write fx equal to q. Then we can control how the external load vector increases or decreases by introducing a scalar quantity lambda and express the system. Thus, by increasing or decreasing lambda, we can control our load incrementation. We introduce the term Ru because we are interested in the general case where the system of equations is not in equilibrium, and therefore, the difference expresses the residual vector, which we then use to find the corrections to our solution. In this system of equations, we are interested in U and lambda. At every increment, we change slightly the value of lambda and try to determine U, so that the system is satisfied. Suppose that the last converged solution is UO and lambda O. The load increment is initiated by postulating lambda dash equal to lambda O plus delta lambda, while delta lambda is a known predefined incrementation parameter. Then we update the displacement UO by U dash equal to UO plus delta U. Then we have a new expression of the system. In the new expression, Fint can be expressed in terms of Fint UO by a Taylor series expansion, where Kt is the Jacobian matrix of the system of equations and is commonly referred to as the stiffness matrix. Now, combining these equations, we can solve for delta U. We continue to provide displacement corrections until a norm of the residue vector is less than the specified tolerance. A schematic representation of the Newton-Raphson method is shown in right-hand side. Now we consider a nodal displacement of a nonlinear spring using the Newton-Raphson method. We find a nonlinear equation and use the convergence tolerance of 10^-16 power, and the initial estimate UO is 0. Also, estimate the convergence rate. Since the problem has a single variable, the problem becomes a nonlinear algebraic equation. In this case, when iteration is 7, the final answer is reached. The quadratic convergence rate of Newton-Raphson method guarantees convergence within few iterations. Faster convergence makes Newton-Raphson method ideal when solving large systems of nonlinear equations, where each iteration costs in terms of computational time. Convergence aside, however, Newton-Raphson method is also associated with a major drawback. The method fails to accurately follow the equilibrium path once the tangent stiffness reaches zero. This happens due to the formation of Newton-Raphson method, and in particular that it restricts the parameter lambda to change monotonically every increment. The definition of a limit point suggests that in order to remain on the equilibrium path, you need to change your loading pattern depending on whether the limit point is a local minimum or maximum in the U lambda space. As a general rule, if the problem under consideration requires information after its critical point, then Newton-Raphson method is not a good choice. Thus, it is necessary to introduce a numerical technique to solve such problem with strongly behavior. The arc length method is a very efficient method in solving nonlinear systems of equations. When the problem under consideration exhibits one or more critical points, in terms of a simple mechanical loading and unloading problem, a critical point could be interpreted as the point at which the loaded body cannot support an increase of the external forces and an instability occurs. Recall one again, the system of the nonlinear equations that we are interested in solving, but we need to provide the necessary corrections small delta u and small delta lambda, aiming that the new point uo plus big delta u plus small delta u and lambda o plus big delta lambda plus small delta lambda will satisfy the nonlinear equation. Using a Taylor series expansion and retaining only the linear terms, we can rewrite the last equation. From now on, we represent the Jacobian matrix of the system defined by the quantity kt. Recall that delta u and delta lambda are the unknowns for whom we need to solve. The supplementary equation that completes the system is called the arc length equation. Psi and delta l are user-defined parameters. When psi is equal to 1, the method is also called the spherical arc length method. Collecting up the two equations, we can write the system of equations we need to solve in a much more compact form. A schematic representation of the arc length method is shown in right-hand side. Now we consider the nodal displacement of the nonlinear spring using the arc length method. In this case, we assume psi equal to 1 and delta l equal to 0.65316. It is easy to know the arc length method can model the decreasing segment of a nonlinear curve. Okay, now we know the two solution methods of nonlinear finite element analysis. Next, we can consider a simple chart structure to compare the two methods. The structure comprises two chart members with initial length lo and cross-section AO that initially form an angle theta O with the horizontal axis. The chart members are homogeneous and are assumed to be made of an isotropic and linearly elastic material. We also assume that it is impossible for the members to buckle and hence they can only shrink under compression. A force P is applied at the hinge point, subjecting the chart members into compression. The displacement of the hinge U can be arbitrarily large as long as the chart members shrink enough for the displacements to be compatible. A possible deformed configuration for the chart is shown in right-hand side. We start from the equilibrium equations, which is expressed in terms of force balance between the externally applied force P and the initially developed forces FL, keeping in mind that the equation must be written with respect to the deformed state. The constitutive equation is obtained, where K is a measure of each member's stiffness. Now we only have to determine the kinematic equations that would relate the hinge's displacement U with the initial and deformed length of the truss members. We expect the kinematic equation to be nonlinear as a result of the preliminary assumption that the displacement U can be arbitrarily large. Based on this figure, we take the Pythagorean theorem and obtain the kinematic equation. Now combining the three equations all together, we get the displacement equation. We now define the normalized load lambda and the displacement A. Then we obtain a new expression of the final equation. From the structural mechanics point of view, it is rather interesting to interpret this type of snap-through behavior under load control and some typical deformation stages that correspond to curve. For reasons that were extensively described in the previous part, it is impossible to capture the structure's behavior using Newton-Raphson method in solving this problem numerically. An example of the result that we obtain if we insist in using Newton-Raphson method is shown in left-hand side figure. On the other hand, as we would expect, using the arc length method, we are able to capture the actual response in this problem, making the arc length method most suitable for such applications. The converged points in the case of the arc length method are shown in right-hand side figure. From conclusions, what we learned, Newton-Raphson method is the most rapidly convergent process for solution of problems in which only one evaluation of the residue is made in each iteration. Arc length method is widely proven to cope quite well in problems with the snapping behavior and is implemented in most commercial finite element software. Okay, thanks to everyone for watching my video today, and I do hope you found the video informative and that you learned some things from it. If you do have any questions, then you can write comments and messages. I am happy to answer any questions. Thanks for your watching.